Today we're talking about the power of your words, and this is the wife edition. This is part five, and I encourage you as a wife to even listen to part four when I talk to the husbands about the power of his words as it relates to talking about the sensuality and sexuality of the power of words when it comes to dealing with our bodies, our affection. You know, we've already talked about the power of the kiss, the power of the hug, the power of affection and touch and cuddling. Now we need to talk about one of the most profound aspects of sexuality, sexual intimacy, that involves our whole sexual lifestyle and intimacy lifestyle in our marriage, and that's the power of our words. And we're talking about the Song of Songs. Many times, especially in the church and as a Christian woman, you know, we're always taught to be a Proverbs 31 woman, and she is phenomenal. I love Proverbs 31. I've written about it in books that I've written. I've definitely preached it. But when it comes to marriage, not only do you want to be a Proverbs 31 woman, you want to be a Song of Songs wife. That is a sexually confident wife. That is a wife who allows her husband to explore her body daily. She's a woman who gives access to her body to her husband, not just for sexual pleasure, but to just have intimacy, to have affection, to have the power of the kiss, the power of the hug, the power of affection, the power of touch, the power of cuddling, the power of hand-holding, the power of just coming together in an intimate way physically. And you have to remember, as wives, we are the only place that is righteous, holy, and sacred before the Lord, where our husband can find sexual pleasure. And our husbands are the only place righteously, holy, in holiness and in sacredness that we can find sexual pleasure. So there is no other option. So the option is for us to come together to bring about a sexual intimacy that can only be shared, which is a gift between the two of us in marriage. So what, I mean, to me, that is just so empowering. As a wife who, in my marriage, we're the opposite, where my husband's a lower desire sex drive and I'm the higher desire wife. You know, I'm that Song of Songs wife, you know, that sexual pursuer in a marriage. And I really want to impart and empower other women to understand this is a gift from God for us to be Song of Songs wife. The Bible tells us that the man was not made for the woman, but the woman was made for the man. You are a gift. Yes, you, my sister, my queen, my girl, you are a gift to your husband, a gift that should be unwrapped every day, no matter how you may feel, what's going on, you know, even in your body or in your mind or with life. I'm telling you, when we allow ourselves to be a gift to our husband, and our husband is a place where we can find security and trust and vulnerability and be naked and unashamed, it can begin to ease all type of stress, even some chronic illness, pains, trauma from childhood. If you really allow the love, especially your love life, to be all that it can be, it can be a healing journey for you. It can bring about such a place of peace, such a place of healing of past wounds and traumas, that you can get to a place of just loving yourself beyond what you imagine. You don't have to always struggle with insecurities and body image issues and not feeling good enough or that you are enough. But if you allow your love life to bring life, and for you all to come together in that aspect every day, even if it's not full-on sexual intercourse, but just, again, the power of kissing, touching, holding, cuddling, just the power of affection, just the power of intimacy and being a gift to one another in that way every day, I'm telling you, it can be life-changing. But just like the Song of Songs, we talk about a woman, her name is the Shulamite woman. She's the wife of King Solomon. And you have to understand, women, there's only been one woman to ever walk the face of this earth that did not struggle with her body image issue. And it was only before the fall of man, and that was Eve. You know, when the glory of God was on her and Adam. So, but after the fall of man, even she had struggles from the fall of man, from Eve on, all the way to every model, beauty queen, I don't care if it's an actress. I don't care if it's a CEO, how powerful or how financially wealthy a woman is, or how beautiful people may say she is. We all have some level of struggle or some level of insecurity when it comes to our body image issues, when it comes to how we look at ourselves and if we are enough. And even she, being the queen, the wife of the king, had an issue. She felt that she was treated poorly sometimes by her family. She felt that she was burnt, that her skin was too dark. But his love was so invigorating, so refreshing, so renewing, so restorative, that she literally makes the statement, even though I'm dark, I'm lovely. Even though I'm dark, I'm beautiful. And that's what real love can do for you. If you allow your husband to love you back to life through the pains and the trauma of your childhood, through sexual abuse, molestation, rape, whatever you've gone through, a heartbreak, men who used you, people who didn't love you, who didn't treat you right, even if they were kin to you or a family friend, if you allow the power of the love in your marriage, what God intended for marriage to be, that helping for us to come together and help one another, not just to achieve goals and dreams, but to build one another up, to be strength, to be empowerment to our weak points, to be empowerment to our vulnerabilities, to be a safe landing spot. If you will allow your husband to be that, and a lot of times that takes you being vulnerable intimately with him in your nakedness of your emotions, in your nakedness of your thoughts, and in the nakedness of your body. But if you allow yourself to be completely and totally naked and unashamed before him, you know, not holding anything back, I'm telling you, it can bring healing like you cannot even imagine in your marriage. And it did it for this beautiful young woman. Even though she was queen, even though she had some family issues, she had some stuff that was going on, the love that she had for him and the love that he had for her brought about such passion that it brought about purpose into their life. Now, you have to understand, men want to be pursued sexually. So we want to pursue them with the power of our words. Before you even touch him, it's all about what you say to him. Because a man will tell you, he can have sex at any given time. But one thing he will not do, he will not lay with a woman that does not respect him. So we want to start with the power of our words. Even before you touch him, you should be touching him with your lips. Not just with the kiss, but just by the words, the sweetness, the gentleness, the kindness of your words. Those things should proceed before you even physically kiss him or touch him. One of my favorite passages in the Song of Songs is when the wife says this. She says in Song of Songs 7:9-10, your mouth is like fine wine flowing smoothly for my love, gliding past my lips and teeth. I belong to my love, and he is my desire. He is a desire for me. Do you desire your husband sexually? Be real, girl. It's just you listening to me. Do you really desire him? And if you don't, then why? And a lot of times that really true desire is really an issue within us than it is with him. Don't allow your self-image issues, your body image issues, your past traumas, hurts, and pain cause you to rip from your marriage the intimacy of sexual fulfillment, which is a gift from God. Don't allow the enemy to continue to win the battle over you by being a force in your marriage to divide you all over sexuality, over sexual intimacy, over being physical, over being affectionate. No matter what is happening in your life, the grace of God, the mercy of God can cover any guilt, any shame, any pain, any trauma. But don't allow Satan to win this battle. Don't allow him to win this war and cause you to withdraw from your husband. To me, sex is an act of worship against the enemy. It's an act of worship unto God because it's such a gift he gives us only in the sacredness of marriage. But then it's an act of worship with each other and to God, but it's an act of warfare against the enemy to let him know you tried us, you tried to destroy us, you tried to destroy our intimacy, but we're coming together and we're going to be together intimately. We're going to be together sexually, and we're going to worship God through our bodies in this way. And when this worship comes forth, it is a warfare against the enemy to silence him. So again, don't make a self issue that you may have with your own self cause you not to pursue after your husband sexually. We should be a seductress to our husband. We should be seducing to him. We should have sexual boldness as it relates to him. We should celebrate our marital sexuality, and we should definitely be naked and unashamed, both intimately, emotionally, and definitely physically. Now, another passage that I love that she expresses to her king, and she calls him her king, her lover, her friend, her groom. And use those pet names when you talk to your husband. You know, find that sweet name that he likes that you know turns him on. But one thing I love in this particular passage, she lets you know, that's my man. Song of Songs, chapter 5, verse 10 through 16, the Message translation says this: my dear lover glows with health. He's red-blooded. He's radiant. He's one in a million. Have you ever told your husband that, wives? Have you ever said, baby, you are one in a million? She goes on to say this: there's no one quite like him, my golden one. He's pure. He's untarnished with his raven black curls tumbling across his shoulders. His eyes are like doves, soft and bright, but deep set, brimming with meaning, like wells of water. His face is rugged. His beard smells like sage. His voice, his words, they are warm and reassuring to me. He has fine muscles rippled beneath his skin. He is quiet and beautiful. His torso is a work of a sculptor. It is hard and smooth as ivory. He stands tall like a cedar, strong and deep-rooted, a rugged mountain of a man. His aroma is that of wood and stone. His words are like kisses, his kisses words. Everything about him delights me. It thrills me through and through. That's my lover. That's my man. Dear Jerusalem sisters. Now, honey, she said a mouthful. And this is what I want you to share with your husband tonight. I want you to take this passage of Song of Solomon, or the Song of Songs, chapter 5, verse 10 through 16. This is the Message translation. Make it your own, but let this be your script, and let him know just how much you appreciate him as a man sexually, and talk about his body. Go from head to toe. That's what I told the men to do in their segment, and I want you to do the same, because they had a beautiful several passages where Solomon talks about the beauty of her body, and this is our passage to talk about the beautiness of his body. Yes, let your man know he is handsome and his body is beautiful and it is desirable. She does it from head to toe. First of all, she lets him know, you're one in a million, meaning I'll choose you all over again. You are my groom, my king, my lover. She says, there's no one quite like you. Oh yes, sweetheart. You know, she dealt with his hair. So let him know if he has hair, let him know how you love his hair. If he's bald, stroke that bald head and let him know that nobody has a slicker bald head than he does and how sexy it is. Then she moves down to his eyes and talks about his eyes. Talk about his eye color and how looking deeply into his eyes is just a blessing to you and how you're enthralled by him. Then she talks about his shoulders and how broad shoulder he is. And then she talks about his beard. If your husband has a mustache or a beard, describe that and talk about how sexy it is. Then she talks about his voice, how warming and reassuring his words are. Let him know that his words melt you like butter. Then she talks about his muscles. Now, honey, if he has muscles or not, baby, lift him up. Lift him up. You know, pump him up. That's your man, and he's your one in a million. So she talks about his muscles. Touch him. Touch those shoulders. Touch those arms and tell him how beautiful and handsome he is. Then she talks about his torso, and she said he is like a work of art to her, like a sculptor did it. If he got a 6-pack or a 12-pack or a no pack, honey, love on that man because he's yours. And then she talks about how tall he is. So no matter if your husband is tall or short, whatever his height, just be appreciative of who he is. Appreciate his body. Then she talks about the smell of him as a man. And honey, you know, spray that cologne on him and let him know how good he smells. And then she talks about his words are like kisses to her, and his kisses are like words. So that's what you should be. Your words should feel like kisses to your husband, and your kisses like words. I mean, he literally should feel the words of affirmation so empowering him that it's like you're kissing him through your lips. And then she says this, that everything about him delights me. It thrills me through and through. And this encouraged me because we all have days where we do feel disappointed by our husbands. We're just going to keep it real. We're women and we're easily disappointed in some things that they do. But this encouraged me to say, take delight in him. Take delight in those small things that sometimes you overlook. Take delight in who he is as a man and let it be thrilling to you again. And then she says this, that's my lover, that's my man. And you tell him that you are my lover and you are my man. And I love that she calls him again, her groom, her king, her lover. She takes delight in him. She brings blessing to him and she brings happiness to her husband. Yes, sexual intimacy, sexual pleasure, and sexual satisfaction brings happiness to our husbands. And you should also want that to bring happiness to you. You deserve to have happiness in this area. God didn't just make it just for him. He made it for you. He made it for your husband. He made it for the both of you. So my question is, do you want to bring good pleasure to his life? If you do, then that's through sex and intimacy. That is one area, not every area, but that's what we're dealing with right now. We're dealing with how sex and intimacy brings about pleasure to our husband's life, not just his body, his life. Share your body, not just sexually, but give him access to touch you throughout the day. I'm shocked when I talk to husbands when they were like, she won't let me touch her, rub her shoulders, nothing. You know, if I wanted to caress her, anything. So even before you become undressed sexually, your husband should have just access to just be able to come and put his arms around you and touch you or kiss you, you know, and not every advance that he makes is that of sexuality. Some of it is just affection. And so we should be open to receive the affection of our husbands. And the Shulamite woman is a woman who wants that affection. And we as women pursuing to be sung a song wives, again, I really want that to be your prayer. God, help me to be, to become, and to stay and maintain and pursue after being a Song of Songs wife, a wife that pursues her husband intimately, sexually, and affectionately. She wants his kisses. She said, kiss me with the kisses of your mouth. Your love is better than wine. You are a pleasing fragrance to me. Pour yourself out on me like oil. And I just love how sexual and sensual she gets with him. She tells him, draw me into you. Let's run off together. You know, let's go into our private bedroom. Let's rejoice and be glad and let's extol in our love, which is better than wine. You know, she lets him know, let's make love. Your words should be empowering your husband. Let him know, I want to make love. One of the things I share with the men in their segment in part four is words to her, H-E-R. So my segment to you is words to him, H-I-M. And I want to use different words for that acronym of him. So in the H, your words should be words of humility and humbleness to your husband. How do you sound when you speak to him on a daily basis? Your words, if they're going to bring power to your marriage and power to your sexual life and power to your lifestyle and intimacy, should be words that bring forth humility and humbleness. They should be words that are honest. Be honest with your husband. But the Bible says speak the truth in love. So be honest, but do it with love. Even when you have to bring those challenging things to him, yet be honest, but do it in love. Your words should be humorous. You need to laugh and lighten up in marriage. Your words should have humor to them. Have fun with him. Joke around with him. Be his playmate. Be his girlfriend in your marriage. I'm telling you, you got to go back to that dating season where you two just had fun, where you didn't just let life just overwhelm you. Your words should be harmonious. They should be unified. The power of agreement has to be in your marriage. You do not want division. Your words should not be divisive all the time. Now, again, it's not the goal to think alike, but it is the goal to think together, to be unified, to be harmonious. And your words should be helpful. You should be helping your husband. As a matter of fact, that's a question you should ask every day. How can I help you today? What can I do to help your day go better? What is it that you have need of me? And then do it. And not have a whole commentary of why do I have to do this and why do I have to do that and you should do this for me. When you ask him, say, and I take pleasure in being able to do that. If it's something as simple as, honey, could you iron my shirt for me? Or could you pray for me? Or tonight, you know, can we make love? Whatever the request is, let your answer be yes. It will be my good pleasure to do that. Now, let's get to the I in your words to him. Your words should be initiating. And of course, I mean initiating, not just sexually, but initiating in intellectual conversation, initiating intimacy. Yes. Initiating with him where he doesn't feel like where he's always the one that has to be the one to pursue after you, but he wants to be pursued in marriage. See, when you're dating, yes, the man should pursue. He should take the lead in that way. But when you're married, it needs to be reciprocity. It needs to be both of you. No one needs to feel like they're doing all the work. You know what? Another thing too, your words, for them to be powerful, need to be interesting. You need to invest in what he's interested in. You know, even if it's not your thing, just say, hey, I would love to just sit and watch this game with you, or tell me about this. You know, I know you love this particular thing or this particular software, this particular game, or I see you on this app, or, you know, I know you like this particular car magazine or this particular whatever. Let it be interesting. The power of your words need to be interesting and be a part of you that wants to engage with him playfully and be interested in the activities and hobbies that he enjoys. And your words definitely have to be inspirational. Wives, the power of our words have to be inspirational. Every day, we need to inspire our husbands. We need to pray for them. We need to speak words of life over them. We need to always speak words of scripture over them. And we need to speak to who we know God has called him to be, even when he's not acting like that, even when his behavior is not lining up with who you know he's called to be. We have to be inspiring to our husband, and we have to be inspirational to him. And finally, our powerful words to him, dealing with him, our words need to be motivating. You know, men can really get down sometime and they have anxiety and depression issues, and we need to help motivate him, to help keep him determined, to help him to know that you are proud of him and you know he can make it, and that you are so appreciative of everything he does for the family. You know, and even if he's a man right now that may be in a stuck season in his life, speak life to him by motivating him, you know, through the power of your words. Our words need to be moving. You know, you need to have words of compassion and empathy and sympathy and be able to move the heart of your husband. You know, most men may say they're not emotional, but a lot of them do. And men do cry in the dark. They do cry when they are alone. So we need to have moving words, words of affirmation that move the heart of our husbands. They need to be meaningful. Don't just say something to be manipulative to get something out of him. Make sure your words are meaningful, you know. And then sometimes, especially if you're married to a man who's not a talker, they need to be momentary, not long-winded, you know. And if you do need to have those long talks and conversations, schedule it. Make sure it's a good TTO, talk time opportunity. Don't just say, we need to talk. You know, be delightful in your words. Be delightful in your speech. Be delightful with a smile. Be delightful with your tone and your body language when you need to talk to your husband about a matter. Sometimes maybe emailing him or sending him a letter or writing him a letter, letting him know what the subject matter is about may help a lot, because that way he feels like he has time to pray over it, get an understanding, and come with the right response. Men really do want to come with the right response as it relates to us. But sometimes they feel overwhelmed. They feel interrogated, you know, by us, and intimidated too, because it's like, you know, she's had all this time. She's thought of it. She got a full PowerPoint, and they just feel overwhelmed. So sometimes, ladies, be momentary. Be shorter with your words, shorter with what you need to say, and get right to the point. Again, that's where me and my husband are opposite. I am a right to the point person, and he is very long-winded. You can get lost in sometimes when he is just talking, going on and on. And publicly, he is a extremely quiet man, but in our marriage, he is a talker. And then publicly, I'm the talker, but I'm very introverted at home and you know, don't talk as much. So we have this joke where it's called, come on and land the plane. You know, it's a marital counselor that came up with that term. And he's like, you have people who are babbling brooks, you know, who just never land the plane. They just go on and on and on. And I'm always like, okay, what's the punchline? What's the big detail here? What is it? You know, and sometimes I tell him, just ask me the question first, then let's talk about the details. But we got to learn as wives, because the rule of thumb, not the rule of thumb, but statistics say that women do tend to have more words than men. So just know sometimes you need to be more in the moment and get right to what the issue is or the situation, and give him time, give him a space of reprieve so that he can get his thoughts together. But, you just want, again, you know, be encouraging, you know, empowering, you know, with him, respectful. You want to be a place of rest for him, a place of rejuvenation and refreshing renewal. And you want to be a place where he can be erotic, you know, in marriage. You know, that's where we can have that. The marriage bed is undefiled, and that's where we can have our freedom. We should not have bondage when it comes to our marriage bed. The devil is a liar, and the Lord has given us freedom. The Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. The Spirit of the Lord is in your marriage bed. I speak it now. There are no chains holding you back, not even trauma and hurt and pain and wounds from past relationships and your childhood. But you have the spirit of liberty today and the power of God, so that you can have a beautiful, fulfilling sexual intimacy lifestyle with your husband. So make yourself beautiful and irresistible to him through and by your powerful words that you speak to him. And I want you to take this thought every day, that you are grateful that God is making you into a Song of Songs wife, so that you can enjoy sexual intimacy and pleasure every single day.